Welcome, Jeremy.
Benjamin. Thanks very much for the kind introduction, and thanks very much to the organizer for organizing an amazing conference and giving me the opportunity to talk. So I'm going to talk about maybe a slightly different approach, how we potentially can improve rice and other like monocotyledonous crop species by using like pattern recognition receptors from dicots. And a little bit more specific, I will be talking about the transgenic expression of the dicot immune receptor EFR and how it improves rice immunity. So I'm sure not everybody in the room is familiar like with the plant immune system, so I'll give a very brief introduction to this. So the plant immune system is kind of like two-layered. In the first layer, you see it's a plasma membrane. You have transmembrane receptors, which recognizes like apoplastic like molecules from the pathogen or also from other bacteria, and sees the most like highly conserved molecules, and therefore also referred to as pathogen associated molecular patterns. And the second layer of immunity is like when plants recognize intracellular effectors from the pathogen, which are either directly secreted in the case of bacteria, or which are like taken up into the plant cells by an unknown mechanism in the case of fungi or mycetes. And these effectors are mostly recognized by MBSLR proteins intracellularly, and this triggers like effector triggered immunity. Today, I want to focus on the plasma membrane localized receptors, and just to remind you, these triggers like multiple like defense responses, and I'm going to use two readouts in my talk. One will be MEK-kinase activation, the other one will be deep antigen expression. So what are these receptors at the plasma membrane? So I'm just going to give you a brief example. So the, for example, XZ21, which was cloned in our lab, which recognizes like a secreted protein from the bacterial pathogen Xanthomonas oryzae, which is specific to rice. Then there's FLS2, which is quite widely distributed in nearly all plant species sampled so far. Then EFR, which is specific to Brassicaceae, and gonna go in detail to this a little later, and which recognizes EFTU. SERC1 from Arabidopsis recognizes chitin. But they're not also receptor-like kinases, but also like receptor-like proteins such as CBIP, which is a very nice work in rice, which is the first chitin receptor, like other lysine-domaining receptors, which either recognize chitin or peptidoglycans. And there are also a couple of apoplastic immune receptors without any linkage to the plasma membrane, such as XZ21D, which we're also studying in more detail. However, not much now is known how these receptors actually trigger immune response. Okay. So EFR. So EFR was initially cloned from Arabidopsis. It recognizes EFTU, which is like the most abundant protein in bacteria. It's a translation elongation factor, and it's super highly conserved. So EFR has 21 extracellular repeats, and it recognizes the N-terminal domain of EFTU, which is highly conserved, and especially if you use like an epitope, which is only comprised of the first 18 amino acids, you can trigger oral responses in the plant. So as I said, this immune receptor is specific to Brassicaceae. So initially, then people thought, okay, maybe we can use this to put it into other plant species to increase immunity. And this was initially done with other dicot species. For example, here in the case of tobacco, so you express tobacco, EFR in tobacco, you don't see like any morphological phenotypes, yet with this readout, like chemiluminescence, if you add L15, it specifically induces a response in the EFR transgenic plants. And then in my old lab, we went on and generated, like also tested if this expression of EFR confers resistance to bacterial pathogens, and yes, it does, and it was quite impressive. So here you see a tobacco plant expressing EFR, which was infected with a tobacco pathogen from Pseudomonas, and it's clearly more resistant than the wild type species. Similar, if you express like EFR in tomato, you see like the EFR transgenic plants become very like resistant to Rustonia, so a different pathogen. So it was quite promising that you could use such immune receptors to confer resistance to multiple different pathogens. So we wanted to know if, okay, if this works in dicots, can we do a similar thing using this dicot immune receptor and express again in a monocot? And we started with rice. For this, we generated two constructs. The first construct just is made out of the whole EFR protein, and we tagged it for GFP at the C-terminus. Or we made a like chimeric receptor comprised of the extracellular domain of EFR and the kinase signaling domain of XC21. And the rationale was, we were maybe thinking that you need a like monocot kinase actually to be able to function in a monocot species. So just here to show you that we like generated several plants which express EFR by RT-PCR, and then we went on and looked for the protein expression, and we generated several lines which showed like relatively high expression level of EFR, EFR-XC21. In addition, as you can see here, this runs around 175 kilodalton, which is higher than the predicted size by just based on the amino acid sequence, which suggests that it's highly glycosylated, which is positive to see because glycosylation is very important for the function of these immune receptors. So this was very promising. So then we wanted to know if this is actually also functional, and what we did, we treated like transgenic plants with LF18 from E. coli, where it was initially identified. And as you can see here, Kitaki is like unresponsive to LF18 as expected, yet plants expressing either EFR or EFR-XC21 are very responsive to these peptides measured by Diefenstein expression. And additionally, we also, the second readout was MAP kinase activation. So here we use an antibody which specifically recognizes the phosphorylated activation loop of MAP kinases. And we first tested this with chitin. So if you, this is another PAM, if you use chitin, you see that the upper band becomes stronger and you see an additional band, which is indicative of the activation of MAP kinases. Then our control experiment was first to put LF18 from E. coli on Kitaki, and which is the rice variety we're using in the lab, and you see that there's nothing going on. Yet if you express either EFR, GFP, or EFR-XC21, you clearly see like the upper band becomes stronger and additional band coming up in both cases. So again, showing that the signaling pathway is definitely switched on. Yet, in all these studies so far, we used like LF18 from E. coli. So the next question was like, how is this EFTU actually conserved in Santamonas? And we mined the genomes of the four published genomes. And here's one example. That's the sequence for LF18 in E. coli, and that's from XO. So there are two base pair substitutions. And we wanted to know if this is conserved, like the substitutions in many different XO, like races. So we copied like the two EFTU genes from over 20 different races from like diverse geographic origin, and the N-terminal part, which is involved in the recognition by EFR, was like 100% conserved. So all have these two amino acid substitutions. The next question, like, is this LF18 from XOO actually recognized? The first indication was yes, it might be, because in the initial study where they described the recognition specificity of EFR, they actually had, by chance, they used exactly the same peptide, which is encoded by the XOO genome, and they showed that this is as responsive as the E. coli sequence here. But we, of course, wanted to test if this is also the case in rice. And we just purchased LF18 from XOO with the XOO sequence. And as you can see here, and again, these two marker genes, Kitaki is unresponsive like to this LF18 as well, but plants expressing either EFR, EFR-XC21 are fully responsive to this peptide, which was very promising. And similarly, like MAP kinases are switched on in a similar fashion with this peptide from XO. So the next step, okay, EFR potentially also like is also able to recognize EFTU from Sansomonas. So can we also improve rice by actually expressing CSR, make it more resistant to Xanthomonas? So our initial experiments were not very promising. So as you can see, I said the lesion lengths after leaf clip inoculation of our strain we work most with, which is PXO99. And you can see here that these two lines, EFR, or expressing EFR or EFR XA21 are not different to ketakine, whereas our control line, the XA21 line, is. Yet we use like a slightly less virulent preparation of the same bacterial strain, which shows like lower lesions, here 25 to 10. And with this less virulent prep, we definitely saw like a reduction in the lesion length when we express EFR or EFR to XA21 to a similar level to XA21. We wanted to confirm this with several other different races of XO. So we tested several strains of our collections, and we found like two more strains which were like showed a very reduced virulence on ketakine. And again, here, if you express either EFR or EFR XA21, you show like a slightly reduced lesion length, and the same is for this other like Japanese race. So yes, it works. It's not like amazing phenotype, but you definitely you see a phenotype if you express EFR, if EFR XA21 in the rice. And these plants are slightly more resistant to XO. So the next question, which is now like a more like scientific interest we have. Now we have like these two immune receptors, either EFR or XA21, and there's some signaling component known for both of them. And we wanted to know if EFR actually uses the same signaling components as XA21 does. So the first step was to do yeast to hybrid between the EFR kinase domain and several signaling components which were identified previously. So I'll just run you through this quickly. So one of them is OSCIRC2, which is a co-receptor, which is important for XA21 signaling, where we also have a poster here. Then we have XP3, which is your U-box protein. We have XP15, which is our like phosphatase. XP24, which is an ADPase. And just here on the right hand, left hand side for you, that XA21 actually interacts with OSCIRC2 because it was not previously published. So to our surprise, we only found that EFR interacts with XP24 in this yeast hybrid. So this was maybe indicative that the signaling pathway is not shared. Yet we know from our Arabidopsis work that EFR requires like orthologous co-receptors in our Arabidopsis to CIRC2 in rice. So we went into the whole plant system and wanted to see if in planta EFR or EFR XA21 interacts with OSCIRC2, and we have an antibody against OSCIRC2 which recognizes OSCIRC2 in the total protein. And now we immunoprecipitated like EFR or EFR XA21 GFP, as you can see here. Nothing came down in the Kitaki control. And in all cases, OSCIRC2 co-immunoprecipitated with EFR, EFR XA21. And this even, like in the absence of the ligand and ligand treatment, actually didn't enhance any of the interaction. So yeah, so EFR probably shares some signaling component, but not all signaling component with XA21. So that's actually already the summary of my talk. So yes, it works, which is pretty nice because there are a lot of like immune receptors known in dicots, which are only present in dicots. So we could use them and express them on monocots and improve resistance. And this would be the first example here that we can express EFR in rice, and rice becomes responsive to alpha-18. And also this contributes slightly to enhanced resistance to weakly virulent strains of XO. Then additionally, for EFR and EFR XA21 trigger like a similar defense responses like MAP kinase activation and defense gene expression to similar levels. Yet EFR appears only to utilize a subset of the known XA21 signaling components. So where we want to go in the future with this we want to go a little bit more in detail in the defense response and maybe also test other pathogens, for example, Xanthomonas aurice or auricular. If EFR is also functional to this, the EFTU is conserved in this in auricular as well, so it could be promising approaches. And we also want to go more a little bit to dissect the EFR signaling pathway, so we cross EFR lines with components, with lines which have a changed expression pattern in these XB, X31 signaling components. So that's the end of my talk. First of all, thanks for actually coming by here. And of course, I would like to acknowledge Pam Nongol to take me on in the lab and give me a great opportunity to work with rice, which I think is very interesting coming from Arabidopsis and far more important in my eyes. And several other people in the lab that I collaborate with, like so Ophia Bahar is a postdoc in the lab, and also Nick Thomas, which is like a PhD student. And Suvi Sen and Shimin Su, we work together on the OSR2 project, the new signaling component XA21. Then we still have like strong links with people from the Sainsbury lab, especially with my old boss, Cyril Zipfel. And also I have to acknowledge Vladimir Nekrasov, who made all these constructs. Ooh. And the funding in the lab is by the National Science Foundation, and I'm personally supported by an AMBO fellowship in Human Frontiers. Thank you very much.